Ladies and gentlemen, hello and welcome back to the ESL1 Frankfurt qualifiers for the North American region. We're going to be taking a look at a battle between North and South. T-Show facing off against Digital Chaos in what should be an absolutely fabulous game number two. There was a lot that happened in the last game. A lot of it ended up being somewhat repetitive because I feel like T-Show just kind of ended up putting themselves in a bit of a hole with how their early game went. Again, Lyrical Dota joined by the Wonder Cat. Sir, what was your impression of the last game, if you could sum it up for us?
Textbook okay. From Digital Chaos. And T-Show, the way that they drafted, they should have known that that was coming, but there weren't a lot of good options for them to deal with it other than just outperform in the lane. They didn't. So it kind of spiraled out of control from there, and T-Show are going to give up the Invoker again, and they're going to try a different strategy this time. Also, getting rid of the Nature's Prophet and the Beastmaster, so clearly pushing is on their mind. They do not want to be split pushed down again.
Yeah, that was a real pain. They did end up giving over the Invoker again, which is something that I think is maybe a little bit questionable. They played a pretty good game out of it. I do think that in the offlane there, Mu did a whole heck of a lot on that Nature's Prophet. It was really freaking strong. But this time instead, we're going to be seeing them go for a little bit more of like the team fighty lockdown type of heroes. You've got Doom, who's going to be able to run at that mid hero throughout the early stages of this game and then eventually drop on down that ultimate. Darkseer as well, but the immediate answer with the Oracle, that's got to hurt playing up against an Oracle with the Darkseer. Just everything gets purged off.
Yeah, it's a pain, but to be fair, Oracle's really impactful if you have a very strong Oracle team, not necessarily a very strong individual Oracle player, because he does require a lot of communication and a very strong sense of positioning. Oracle is one of the least successful heroes this patch in professional Dota, across the patch for just about every team, despite the fact that he has been relatively popular in the second part of the patch. So just because the Oracle comes out and is able to do quite a bit of purging does not necessarily mean it will be used to an optimal efficiency, right?
Yeah, most definitely. And, you know, you want to be able to see those sort of big plays in the laning stage where you're able to get off a Fortune's End, but it doesn't always end up working. Maybe Darkseer is able to get away further enough before you're able to release the channeled things. Like, those are the types of things that you need to be a little bit careful about. And I really want to see who they pair up in that lane as well, because one of the other things to keep in mind is that you have the capabilities with the Invoker now of after you end up, you know, going for that purge, then Darkseer is going to be walking that constant speed. You're going to be able to lay down a Sunstrike, and maybe you end up finding the kill. So I do worry a lot about Darkseer in the laning stage, but I think you're right that if you play it well enough, maybe you end up being able to get out of this lane with a decent amount here.
Yeah, of course, the other heroes in the draft will make a difference. If there is more from Digital Chaos in terms of lane control, especially hard stuns, maybe a hard stun carry such as a Sven or a Chaos Knight coming out, and then an additional hard stun or reliable disable support to come out in a tri-lane, Darkseer could be in a lot of trouble. Alternatively, a ranged carry that doesn't have to be within Ion Shell area won't be able to be zoned by Darkseer. So there are a lot of responses to this Darkseer available in the pool still.
Absolutely. Well, for now, at least we're going to be seeing the Spectre banned out. I think that that's one of those heroes that if you're able to just sort of pick it up with anybody that has that like strong single target lockdown, pretty much somebody's going to die in the game. Like you get a Doom into a Haunt and then whoever it is really not going to stand a whole heck of a lot of a chance. So I like that. The OD was also taken out a little bit earlier. We've got the Enchantress, no Bambi this time around. Is there any hero that you feel like, I guess neither side has really shown their cards as to what they're going to end up running as a general strategy. Is there something that you feel like you would like to see out of T-Show, given how bad the game ended up going last time? Maybe shoring up their lanes a little bit, or maybe trying to go for like an early pushing lineup or something like that?
You know, what it comes down to is that they need to be drafting what they're comfortable playing. And remember, they have had three player changes over the last, I think, month or two. So they are still figuring it out, and they by no means were a power player in this region prior to those changes, right? I mean, they're good players, not to take anything away from them, but we've not seen them at a significant LAN. We don't see them coming up into semifinals or finals, even in regional contests like the BTS Americas. So this is a squad that needs to play more to their own strengths than trying to counter opponents, I think, right? They need to make sure that they know what they're doing, and they got to stay out of their own heads to a certain degree. 5 seconds. It's really easy to theory craft yourself into a hole.
Definitely. And like, just look at a hero and then try and counter it without necessarily thinking about the general scheme of how you want the game to go. I'm very curious what they end up bringing out here. With the Enigma pick, it does feel like DC are maybe playing things a little bit on the greedier side, although it's not easy to sort of punish an Enigma nowadays. I feel like I always feel like the classic answer was the Bounty Hunter, but now you're at a situation where you're going to be able to, like, you know, potentially kill off a Bounty Hunter if he shows and starts trying to steal your creeps with an Enigma. If you do have, like, just a sentry ward on you or a dust, like, things could go awry very quickly.
Yeah, the Bounty Hunter is the seventh most successful hero this patch so far, if you count success as whether or not a team wins against more successful teams or loses against less successful teams. Bounty Hunter's actually been really good this patch overall. Mm-hmm. He has been much less picked this patch than in prior patches, but since the Shanghai Major, his pick rate's gone up over the average about 9%, and his ban rate's gone up over 30%. Yeah. So, you know, it's a hero that's becoming back into the consciousness right now, and players at high-level pubs are very aware of this because he is one of the most popular heroes. I think he's the third most popular hero in 5K and above pubs right now as well. So certainly a hero that we could see come out in response to the Enigma, but even without him...
He has been banned out, but I was saying like that there's nobody else that even really fits with trying to deny out... like the jungle, that's sort of the predominant one to be able to work. And even him, I don't feel like it works very well. Is there anything else that potentially could like work, or do you just try and run sort of a maybe aggressive dual lane with the Darkseer and then rotate into the jungle?
They could run an aggressive dual lane. I don't necessarily think that they need to. They do have a lot of answers to the Enigma, right? I mean, they have two ways to cancel from their support. They have a vacuum to cancel that does have a mini stun from the Darkseer. They've got Doom has not only Doom, but also Infernal Blade. So if you don't catch, literally, if you don't catch every single hero as the Enigma, you probably get your Black Hole canceled. That's a high bar to set. So his laning phase, now that I see the Bounty Hunter was the first ban of the game. you know, his laning stage should be more or less all right. You don't usually see supports abandon lanes in order to try and hunt down a jungler too extensively, because while you're doing that, you're not getting any experience, you're not getting any gold, and unlike rotating onto a laning hero where you know for sure where the laning hero is, you don't know where an Enigma is. He could be anywhere because you can't see him.
Yeah, absolutely. It's definitely one of those issues, and actually finding him now, especially with the added camps and everything else that comes along with that, it's a real hassle. We do see the Tidehunter banned out. We're not going to be seeing that sort of double bubble strategy, at least at this point in time. They could go back for a Faceless Void or something crazy like that if they really want to double down on it. They do have a lot of damage that's coming out from the Clinks as well, and you know, with Soxa taking that Enigma, it feels like there's going to be a lot of potential for already some good team fight coming out. And they're going to opt to ban out the DP. Another sort of high-tier mid-player or mid-hero could we end up seeing? Do you think this could be a Zeus game potentially, or is that too dangerous with the Clinks?
Could be a Zeus game in that Zeus is going to provide some vision advantage. He should lane just fine into the Invoker. But like you said, the problem therein is the Clinks. The vision advantage that would provide on the map would also help open up space for the Gyrocopter when he hits his first Doldrum. Mm-hmm. Gyrocopter, one of these heroes that peaks really fast and then levels off for like 10 minutes and then hits another peak and levels off. Not a lot of heroes have that ebbing and flowing efficacy in a game. Usually it's some variation of a linear efficacy. So Gyrocopter is an interesting hero to try and open up space for in terms of windowing.
That's a hell of a word right there you got, by the way. I'm in love with it.
Wait, which word? I said a lot of words.
Efficacy.
Efficacy. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm illiterate, I think. So it's good to hear stuff that's high level. Anyways, we've got
Puck is going to come out.
just smooth right on past that one. They're going to go for the Puck, and they do go back for the Faceless Void. Interesting.
So Puck is a hero who also has been growing in popularity a little bit over the average since the Shanghai Major, but. Puck is literally the least effective hero this patch. Only a handful of players are reliably winning with Puck, and most of the time when Puck is chosen, ranking for the team goes down on average. T-Show are already playing into a squad that just has more experience as players and really just kind of railroaded them last game. I'm a little worried about the Puck pick because it is a difficult hero to execute as a team. Yeah.
Well, the other thing to keep in mind here, though, is that you mentioned it earlier. If this is a comfort hero for them, if this is
That's
a hero
true.
that they feel like they are going to be able to make moves across the map on, then you got to take it. You really do, even if it's not necessarily the best option. So I am very excited to see what the Soothsayer is going to be able to bring to the table. I want to see if Tisha are going to be able to fight their way back on into this game, or if DC are going to be able to pull away with a clean 2-0 sweep. Can do a quick little introduction for these fine folks here. Soxa is going to be on that Enigma. It's going to be Mu playing the Faceless Void. Resolution is going to be playing the Invoker. Weeha on that Klinx. And then last but not least, out here to the side, Misery on the Oracle. Would you care to introduce those fine folks on the northeast side of the map?
Absolutely. Here on the dire side for Tisha, we've got C4T walking on coals with the Doombringer. Tavo is going to be going faster on the Darkseer. Soothes is the Fairy Dragon. Puck himself. Bardo is going to be bringing Nightmares on the Bane, and Carlin is taking Gyrocopter for a spin.
Oh, wonderful. Look at that set, by the way. He's got, like, a cross right there or something. The Jesus Gyrocopter is going to be moving along the top lane and running into Mu, although I think that they're going to end up backing out. Yeah, it's fine for the moment, but pretty unique set.
I've never seen that set. I feel like he's about to take us to Never Never Land.
Absolutely. Michael Jackson's domain. So is there any team in particular that you favor going into this one as far as ease of execution go, as far as sort of team fight potential, and just generally who do you think is going to win the game here?
I think the draft synergy from Tisha on paper is much better. But I think for Digital Chaos, they've demonstrated that they're just, as a team, more cohesive, better communication. So I would lean toward Digital Chaos in terms of my overall belief. But in terms of draft, I do think Tisha have that synergy.
Well, and Gyrocopter and Puck both picking up the Bounty Rune. So a pretty nice little start there for Tisha. They're going to be able to put themselves in a pretty nice start to this game. As far as the mid matchup goes, is there a particular side that you favor? Do you think it's going to come down to the rotations? What are your thoughts there?
So Puck tends to like to play into heroes that don't run bottles because he controls the rune much more easily, and he is a spammer. Puck is one of the heroes that, in terms of lane control, actually does just a little bit better than Invoker. He's a little bit less likely to die, and he, on average, gets one or two more creeps by that 10-minute mark. So it's a pretty even lane. The one thing I will say is on rotations, Puck is much harder to kill with the rotation, whereas Invoker tends to be an easier target.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. And I think that that's something that we're going to need to keep in mind with this Doom here, although he is already going to start this off. Oh, wow. My God, this might end up being a quick early kill. Can they find it? Need one more hit, but they're not going to be able to do it. Sunstrike from afar! Invoker takes first blood. Resolution doing things big right at the start.
There's that level of communication we were talking about. Resolution walking in and ready not only with that map awareness, but Misery just absolutely aware of what a Doombringer is going to fall back and do here for the first couple of levels, and really just willing to go out and get it done. You don't see that very often, the single support aggressive rotation onto the offlane camp because there's a Doombringer.
Well, and you recognize it's partially also because, like, Darkseer is over here in the jungle. They realize that Doom's going to be over there as well. It's pretty hard, I think, to stand up to this lineup. By the way, Resolution falling a little bit low here. He's going to be battling slightly. Can he actually hit another Sunstrike? That'd be pretty big, but is going to end up solving up. So no chance for it. Pretty even start to this game. Mu's going to heal back up as well. And after that first kill, it looks like things are going to slow down a little bit.
Yeah, also that first kill did come down a little bit of misfortune for C4T because he was not able to get a creep with an armor aura off that camp. If he was able to get like a Wildwing Ripper or something, the right clicks from Oracle would not have done nearly as much damage, and he probably would have lived. It's just one of those little things that ends up making a big difference in the course of the laning phase.
Well, and again, over here, Tavo doing his best on the Darkseer. You're going to have the rotation that comes in now as Soxa is going to be trying to zone out C4T. They're going to trade hits in the middle lane as well, and everybody's kind of living on the edge at this point. Is pushing themselves to the very limit. Tavo's actually going to have to run away. Is he going to die to this? Ooh, this is dangerous. Do not end up accidentally killing yourself.
Well, fastest way back to the Fountain, right? I guess.
Yeah.
He didn't buy out before he died, so he did lose half of that creep's value just from that moment.
Yeah,
that hurts. If he had gotten it before he died, probably not worth it in that case. But I just want to point out something that Soxa was doing over on this hill when the Doom rotated in with double damage. Hmm. He had two of his Eidolons up on the high ground to provide vision. So the Doom was waiting on the high ground, and Enigma could see it the whole time. Just really nice micro. So once again, one of those little things that you kind of revel in when you see players doing it.
Oh, Sooth's almost getting killed off there by the Sunstrike, but with the bottle bringing coming out to him, he is going to be able to heal a little bit more, and that was Resolution's potential option to kill him, and didn't end up quite working out, unfortunately. So this is where things get a little bit more scary, I feel like, almost, in the mid lane, is yeah. Rezo.
Yeah, no, I'd agree with that. This is the stage where Puck is going to be doing the best into an Invoker, and as Invoker gets up a couple of his Quas for the regen sustain and some more damage from Exhort, he will start to catch up a little bit. But look at where Sooth is. He doesn't have an orb for jaunting away either anymore.
Yeah, they've got heroes that are rotating in. You mentioned it. He's not got it for another 3 seconds about. Can they find it? They end up being able to get that off, and he is going to try and run away there. Does manage to find his way out. And he's playing so freaking aggressively, and there's just not a great way to punish that right now, I guess.
Yeah. Well, it's that stage in the game where nobody really here has the lockdown or damage to do it. And Sunstrike, there was no mana for it for the Invoker. So had he had mana, that may have been a kill. It would have been enough if it landed. But Sooth's just being a pain in the butt, really.
A little bit. He is definitely messing around. Oh, a nice little orb dodge there. They're at the turnaround here. He's actually using his orb offensively, and it's going to end up being able to go down. They find the Sunstrike. Resolution dropping a little bit low. They do have the surge now. C4T is going to try and right-click Rezo, but not going to be able to find the kill. Unfortunate. The rotation in from the Enigma at that level 6 dissuaded them from going any further. So they find one and don't end up losing their mid. A pretty nice little trade there for DC.
Yeah, DC are happy. As long as this laning stage basically breaks even, they can get up a good time on the Midas for Invoker, who is once again going Exhort and Quas. The Faceless Void needs some basic items to be effective as well. And Klinks, of course, is basically free farming. So the laning phase breaking down pretty heavily in their favor, I would say, all things considered. But the Gyrocopter is getting a decent amount of farm, so that's at least a consolation prize here for Tixio.
Yeah, it's true. He's been able to get himself a nice little bit. I mean, the top of the last hits right now is going to be that Enigma who's been able to have the jungle completely and totally to himself, and currently the fifth highest, rather sixth highest in terms of the net worth. He's trading off with the Darkseer. I'm actually really surprised how well Darkseer has been able to do in the jungle, despite the fact that it's going up against the Enigma, essentially, and he did die that one time. So he's been able to have an okay time. Meanwhile, in the mid lane, they have been able to drop the black hole. Resolution's trying to stay alive. He does end up going down to the Puck, and I think that was maybe either the coil snap or potentially just the creeps right clicking them. In the meantime, can they kill off this Doom? They need to find a little bit more, but it's not enough damage. So they trade one for one in the mid, and it looks like Oracle barely able to walk away with his own life.
Yeah, Oracle threw down that Purifying Flames just literally a half a second too early to make that kill happen.
Moo, top lane. That's going to end up...
Whoa!
Quick fingers. Nicely done.
Good play by Moo. The Void is a difficult hero to lock down and grab kills here without actually having some sort of a long-term hold like the Fiend's Grip. And Bane's still only level 4. I'm not sure that... Well, Moo is actually staying pretty far forward. But in general, if he plays decently safe, they don't have a lot of kill potential on him.
Well, and you know, that goes to show, like, I totally thought that was just going to end up being a kill, but able to jump to the other side. I kind of wonder if Karlin had dropped the, you know, the call down a little bit further forward and had this rocket barrage going, maybe they would have been able to find it, but it is a really hard kill to find regardless on that Faceless Void. As far as the net worth story goes, so far you've got three of the top four that are on the side of DC with Invoker, Enigma, and Klinks all up there, and now Gyrocopter and Puck catching back up as well. It does look like they want to make a rotation with this Faceless Void Chronosphere, though, and if they're able to find Tooth here in the mid lane, this would be a pretty big kill.
Do they have the lockdown to make this kill happen, though? It's a problem. They have a Chronosphere, so if they have the damage through the duration of Chronosphere, but Puck is gone. He's under his own smoke. He's taking his bat and ball and going home, or I guess more appropriately, into your home and getting ready to use that bat and ball to break your knees, because Klinks could be in trouble here.
Do they have any dust, though? That's the question. They actually
they do
on the Bane. He's going to run away, but they don't find him. He runs off the other direction, and a little bit of a duck and dive and dodge in mid lane. They're going to end up diving for this one, as they are going to be able to catch the Doom. Sunstrike is there, but is it enough damage? It doesn't quite look like it. As Misery is going to start to get chased down as well. He does have the heal there, as they are going to be able to jump forward. Dreamcoil only on to Moo. On the other side, Misery is still alive. They have almost been able to kill off the Puck as he does go down, and it looks like that's going to be the sole casualty from the Radiant. They might even be able to take a tier 1 tower off of this if they want.
Yeah, Puck went in a little too aggressively on that, I think. While his opponents were between the Tier 1 and Tier 2, they had every little bit of advantage that they wanted, especially with the Chronosphere down. But as soon as they started to get away, I think Puck probably could have seen their damage just isn't really there. With the Gyrocopter not quite farmed yet, he's only sitting on top of Phase Boots. So it's not like Gyrocopter can go barreling into these fights yet. He has no survivability at all.
Yeah. No, it's definitely true. And I guess for that, would you think that he needs to go for like one of those early Sanjin Yashas? Does he try to go for Helm of the Dominator here to build up a little bit of a net worth advantage? Do you think that they can even sort of wait that long? Do they need something to come online right now?
Helm of the Dominator is a safe enough play here. Oh,
we might actually have a kill real quickly. Trying to turn around, kill off Tavo. Nice stomp to be able to cancel that out, and they find we regardless. Oh, Sunstrike? Cool.
Narrow escape. In the mid lane, they might be looking on going on Suze, and they are.
Cold Snap? He used that as well now, his phase shift.
There we go.
They had Black Cold, so but he actually doesn't end up sticking. He sticks around a little bit longer, and I don't think he's going to get this denied. This is a pretty easy tower.
Yeah, he stuck around to keep those creeps off the tower, but it barely delayed anything. So what I was going to say is the Helm of the Dominator would be a relatively safe call here because there is nobody on the Radiant side that knocks down Ancient Stacks really effectively, right? Mm-hmm. So you don't have to worry about one hero coming up and stealing your stacks as opposed to many other situations where you might be running that strategy. Mm-hmm. As long as they've got vision in the general area and are checking on it fairly frequently to make sure the whole team doesn't come over to steal stacks, the Helm of the Dominator would give Gyro the fastest launching point. But it is more common these days than it used to be to run that Sanjin Yasha. Oh boy, speaking of the Gyrocopter, he's
God.
Done.
That hurts. That really hurts. That's not a kill that needed to not happen for Tisho. A quick and easy pick right there for Weeha, and I don't know, this is if you find pickoffs like that in your jungle, it just can't happen, I feel like, if they want to be able to win this game. They are going to chase now after Misery, and with the Dream Coil committed, they do find that kill, but that is so much for that one. And now they're going to end up turning this back around. Doom has been dropped onto Enigma. Going to chase here a little bit further forward. They do have the Chronosphere. Going to catch onto two. Oh, no. This is going to be a problem. Sunstrike is going to go onto Tavo. And now, can they find anything else? There's going to be the Fiend's Grip onto Wii. Trying to bring him down pretty low. They do have a lot of damage that's coming out. The Silence as well. And they find the kill with the Brain Sap coming out from Bardo. The Puck got the last hit. But still, they kept alive. Well, I guess that's not really worth it. They only got one for that. And the Chronosphere was dropped.
Oh, yeah, that was great for Tisho. It wasn't very smoothly executed, but the end result was fantastic for them. The mm-hmm. only hero that lost gold on their team was the Darkseer, and all things considered, they swung about 1,100 in their favor, which at 11 minutes is a pretty decent swing.
Absolutely. It looks like Gyrocopter's actually going to be going back for drums at this point, or at least the casual Bracer is feeling like he needs to be a little bit more potent right now.
Well, he did go for the Aquila, so hitting the Aquila. And Aquila actually came out a little bit late, later than you would expect anyway, right? So running into Aquila drums build implies that they are going to try and group up and do a lot of team fighting. That makes a decent amount of sense considering how much AoE they have. They've got Vacuum Wall into Dream Coil, into Call Down with the splash damage from the Flak Cannon. They've got Orb, Illusory Orb. They have Waning Rift, right? They do pretty well when opponents are grouped up and ready to be knocked over.
That being said, as we are going to see the top tower, or rather bottom tower already go down and the top tower as well, you don't actually have any points right now for Enigma in the vacuum. You just got the first one right here, so it might end up being a little bit of an issue. Enigma actually ends up being able to get the tower destroyed, and now you catch two as well. Oh, they've already got him with the black hole, and if they need to, they can even drop a little bit more onto him. That's two dead. Oh, that was not the TP.
You cannot be letting that happen. If you are going to TP that far forward, your allies cannot be standing in the event horizon of a black hole from that Enigma. Like, there was no excuse. There's no blink coming in there. Enigma was literally just standing there in advance. Tisho's, that's one of those things that I was talking about to start the game, where Tisho's communication does not always seem to be really on par or up to the bar that DC are setting.
Casually walk into resolution, and that's going to be a pretty nice kill for them. Doom was the one that ended up picking it up, and pretty well worth it. I think that was something that was definitely needed for their team, and you look at it, it's going to end up being actually about a 1,600 gold swing just off of that one kill, and now you take a look at the difference in terms of team net worth over the past couple of minutes. It's definitely been in the favor of DC, but that one helps sort of stem the flow of the blood going back the other direction, so pretty well played.
It's all about damage mitigation for Tisha right now, right? You get what you can get. It's going to be worth more because of the 6-8-2 comeback mechanics that are still to some degree in place. Kills are worth quite a bit at this stage in the game, especially when you are pretty far behind and you are towers behind. That's the biggest factor for this stage in the game for that AoE comeback gold is, are the kills that you're getting being influenced by a tower gold differential and not just a kill gold differential?
Mm. Yeah, and that's something that right now you've still got towers taken, but not all of the tier twos yet. I think some of this you could say is... probably a lot of it, I guess, would be the tower gold that has led them to this type of advantage. But they've also just been farming really effectively. Like, you look at the CS right here, and Enigma up at the top, as well as the Clinks by a significant margin. Now Invoker, too. All three of them. They've just been farming really efficiently and using the map well, I feel like.
Yeah, no, they have been doing a good job of maximizing their input or their economic gain based on the amount of control that they've been able to take, right? They're not sitting on their laurels and hanging out on their own side of the map after taking tier ones. They're annexing territory, and that's really what DC did last game as well that led to such a decisive victory. Mm. And it breathes confidence to me, is really how it feels like. Not only have we been able to take objectives, but we're confident that we'll react in time if one of our allies gets picked on. We'll be able to make sure that we get everything working.
Well, they've already committed the Dream Coil here. They don't have Black Hole for this. This could actually be really bad. They dropped the Chronosphere, but there's still a lot of damage on the other side. Invoker already killed off the Puck, though, and now turning back around, they are going to lose the Enigma at the end of the day, and I think that Moo might go down as well as he is going to end up getting Fiend's Grip. So a nice combo there as they rotated in several heroes, and unfortunately, the rest of the damage, the rest of the control was not quite enough to be able to turn that one around for DC. Do they find Weeha? It doesn't look like it for the moment. They've actually dropped down a Nightmare on the other side. Are going to be able to jump onto Resolution, but the turnaround is right there as well with the Strife. Vacuum back onto two. They've been able to get off the False Promise, though, and keeping Rezo alive. This could be really bad for Tisha. The disarm is there as well. Do they have enough damage? They end up losing Rezo. One last shot there from Weeha ends up finishing off the Doom, and it looks like Misery might go down as well. So four already. One more to follow as he ends up getting parked in this way by a creep, and that's going to be a full team wipe. Really well played by Tisha.
Yeah, that's exactly what Tisha wants, right? They do have to worry about a little bit of AoE synergy coming out of DC. But there's a lot more AoE synergy coming out of Tisha. Whenever they can take those like 4 or 5-on-5 fights, they should come out ahead, even with a decent gold disadvantage, which is now shifted. It's cut by half, basically, after that fight. So they're pretty much back in this game on that one maybe positional disadvantage from DC.
God, that was really good. I feel like that's sort of the impetus here for them to be able to make something else happen. And at 16 minutes into the game, if you've been able to bring the net worth lead down and, you know, go to about 3,000 or so roughly with difference in earned experience at about 2,500, this is a pretty great spot for them. I feel like they're at least now in a capability to take this type of fight, and they're going to at least... I guess this is just a nightmare to be petty for the Bane as he walks away.
Yeah, did he TP'd out of there, right?
Yeah, he did.
Nightmare, make sure that he doesn't get hit with a time lock.
Yeah.
Just that safety valve Nightmare, I guess.
Definitely.
Moo is pretty far forward here, though. I guess he feels safe because everything was used in that last fight, but Doom's ult is up in 4 seconds, and there's no way for Moo to be confident that he's not being smoked on right now. He is going to TP away. That's smart.
Yeah. Well, now they're all going to back out. Do you think that they need to start thinking about Roshan at this point with the Desolator finished?
Looks like they might be thinking about it now. Do they have a smoke? They do have a smoke. They're going to smoke, try to grab a pick off, and then probably collapse into the pit.
Hmm.
They might just... This is really risky. They do not have the AoE to control this if it turns into a choke point fight, and it's going to the counter smoke coming out here. They know.
They have a black hole. They get the silence off, though, and this could be a big issue. They have jumped forward. They drop down the Chronosphere, but it's only onto Tavo. Is that going to end up being enough? Darkseer dropping low. He does die before the Chronosphere comes off. They get the stun as well onto Crit. He's not going to end up getting off his Doom, and suddenly everybody from Tisha is dying.
Wow.
Triple kill for Weeha. Oh, goodness gracious. That was beautiful.
That should not have gone that way. The AoE control for Tisha, the damage is there. The cooldown, I think it really comes down to that Darkseer didn't get a vacuum off before he died, and I don't think he got to use his mech either. That makes a big difference in these fights, right? The vacuum wall, if that wall had landed right through the middle of that fight, game over, man. DC would have no ability to control what's happening. So really well played by DC to single out that target. It was a one-man Chronosphere, but it was the man they needed.
they got their man. Whoever it was that they needed to get, they took him out. Yeah, and, you know, for getting a one merit chronosphere, for not using the black hole in that fight, they went on the people they needed to, and really, really well played. Despite the fact that they did just, you know, throw away a good amount of gold up in that top lane, you look at it now and they're back up on top again. 10k net worth lead in terms of experience and gold. They're in a great spot. And with the Desolator completed on Klinks as well and Aegis now up on Invoker, it does feel like they're going to start having their way a little bit with Tisho.
Yeah, the problem with this Drums Aquila build is that there's some armor on it, but after the Desolator, he's only going to have like 12% physical damage resistance. Which is, ideally, in a perfect world, you want all of your heroes, especially your core heroes, to at least have the same physical damage resistance that they have magical damage resistance of that 25 base.
Tavo? Oh, nice awareness right there in the bottom lane. You talk about it right there. He had, you know, the 9 armor. It helps out a lot against that Desolator, and he almost ended up going down to the Sunstrike, but backed out at that last second. Meanwhile, over here on the side, they drop down the call down for Mu. They're going to turn it back around with the Chronosphere. Do they have actually enough damage, though? Sunstrike's already been used, and only Misery is here, as well as the Black Hole. It's going to come out. It doesn't actually catch Bardo, but Carlin might be enough for them to take this one. There's going to Sunstrike on the other side. They find the kill onto Bane, and it looks like they are going to lose that Gyrocopter as well. So it didn't look pretty for a moment, but they ended up making it work by the end.
A Resolution is a monster on this Invoker. I cannot believe they didn't ban this out. He has been just sunstriking for days through both of these series, right? There's no there's no way Tisho will make that mistake again if they are forced to go into a game 3. Which is looking increasingly unlikely.
Puck almost went down there, was able to escape at the last second, so he's good for the moment, but in the meantime, with still 15 seconds before Gyrocopter comes back up, they are pressuring this top tier 2 very heavily, and it looks like it's going to fall uncontested.
Yeah, that still a lot of summonables.
Well, Mu is up front and center. He is not going to die to this. Vacuum onto 4. No wall has been dropped in. Tavo just gets destroyed. They might think about running back in here. What is going on, though? They didn't have their carry with them.
Yeah.
Oh.
That was a weird time to decide to engage for those two.
Yeah.
To put it lightly.
That was not the best.
Yeah, Dota's a team game, guys. It's not pairs tennis. You gotta have 5. Especially when you draft it to 5-man fight, right? They've got big AoE ults from a lot of their heroes, a lot of splash damage coming out from even the ones that don't, and now they're going to see.
God, look at that damage coming out from Wii. He's just so strong, and they're going to jump forward, but the alacrity to up Weeha is just doing too freaking much and is going to be able to take this one on out as well. They throw out the Illusory Orb. Everybody's back there. That's actually going to be a 4-person catch in the vacuum wall, and everybody's dropping really low. Sasuke's going to go down. Rezo's going to go down. That's 4 heroes. The Aegis already popped. Can they get another one here? I think that Rezo might be able to walk away, ghost walk out, but no, there's the dust, and he is going to end up falling here in a second. There is going to be the Fiend's Grip committed, and already going to be a 3,400 gold swing, a little bit more off the back of that Rezo kill. A little too far forward, but they get a lane of Rax.
Yeah, 5,300 is not what you want to be giving away right now, but they still have an 8,000 net worth lead after the net worth chart updates that, right? And they also got a lane of Rax. It's not the worst trade that DC could have possibly made. And once again, I was talking about this last game, but a lot of teams get off to this sort of start, and then they're unable to really just force an objectives engagement on the high ground. They taper off. DC are not wasting any time making sure that they at least take some objective advantage while they know they have the advantage. They're not going to tarry, they're not going to linger, and they're going to make sure that they get in and sow the seeds, right, for future success.
Yeah, absolutely. And they need to sort of do that off the back of, you know, continuing to take objectives when Roshan is back up again. Do you think that they can try and push before that happens, or do they just try and sort of secure map control at this place, at this pace, and put themselves in a position to take that later?
I'm sorry, I didn't quite catch it. You broke up a little bit.
Oh, no, I broke up. I'm sorry, man. Do you need to try and, like, make a move across the map and find pickoffs at this point by taking over map control, or do you think that they can try and push high ground before that happens again, or maybe just clear out the tier 2s?
Let's see. In terms of items, it looks like they're looking for a BKB on Invoker. It wouldn't be a terrible idea to wait for that Invoker to grab that. It shouldn't take very long, 2 or 3 minutes. At that point in time, Roche will be closed up, but they can knock down these tier 2 towers with probably very little contest. And I don't really see the harm in seeing what they can get done here. just kind of feeling out. You can actually tell. Like, right, Mu is up here on his own. His team is kind of waiting behind just in case there's an engagement. They're trying to force out an engagement from Tisho that's staggered less in their favor.
They've caught Mu at least, and they end up being able to get the false promise off. Black Hole is available, but Sasa Joel low. He gets it onto three, but he might not survive it with the BKB there. He's actually going to be able to live through it. He does end up dying there in the end, but already killing off three, and the doomed Mu is just chasing after the puck. Come at me. They've already killed off the Bane as well, and now on the other side, can they finish off the puck? He's running over the other direction. My goodness, my camera is losing all control of itself. He popped the Chronosphere just to finish off the puck, because why not? At this point, five heroes dead, but more importantly, Barrack soon to go down, because Weeha is a monster, and GG ends up getting called. DC, take game number two.
Yeah, well played by DC. That last fight where they staggered out and made sure that they weren't giving Tisho another engagement on a choke point with five heroes vulnerable, just goes to show, once again, their positional communication is just really stellar, especially considering they're a new team.
Yeah, I'm really freaking impressed with DC. And, you know, Tisho, not necessarily the strongest of opponents ever. They've been struggling recently trying to format their own roster as well. But it does at least show in this instance that you've got a team that works well together. There's been these pieces that I feel like it maybe wouldn't have been as clean if they weren't like a solid unit. So I'm very excited to see what ends up happening throughout the rest of this. Any final thoughts before we take a break before our next series of the day?
Just looking forward to be coming back for some more ESL.
Absolutely. It's going to be Evernova facing off against Shazam. That's going to be taking place in just a little while. I will let you guys know out there when the next game is going to take place as soon as we end up going away for a second. But thank you all so much for tuning in. Give us a follow if you feel so inclined at Lyrical Dota, at The Wonder Cow. They're up there in the upper right-hand side of your screen. And for now, at least, have a great one. We'll see you in a bit.